Devens County Board of Commissioners Transportation Committee meeting as of Tuesday, April 17, 2018, to order. We've got a pretty full agenda here. I don't believe that there will be a reconvening today. I think we have sufficient time to keep it within the relative 1.5 hour, 2 hour time period. Meeting has been called. First up on the agenda is to approval of the meeting minutes from our last March meeting. Has everybody had a chance to get a copy of it first? Please confirm everybody got a copy of it electronically.
Yes, sir.
Has everybody had a chance to read it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Any comments and changes have made? Levine, Milligan? Right. So if there's no comments and edits, can I get a motion to adopt the meeting minutes?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right, motion passes to adopt the March 20, 2018 meeting minutes. Okay, we're gonna jump right in. I'm gonna make one edit that needs to be added to the agenda, and I'd like to get a motion to support it. We talked about this in yesterday's finance committee meeting. We also broached it during the work session. A couple of topics came up regarding transportation-related issues, and I thought it was appropriate to bring before our committee. So I'd like to amend the agenda by adding this one item, and we've invited our finance director and her team to speak to it.
What is the item?
The Greta Fund.
Okay. So moved.
Second.
All in favor to amend the agenda?
Aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Jennifer, you're up. I'll be sensitive to your time.
Sure.
Get you in and out, and we'll get back to our agenda.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. As you know, we are in the middle of our audit process with a normal audit process, but we actually have new auditors this year, Malden and Jenkins. They had brought a couple of things to my attention, and we brought them before the Finance Committee and as
Hey, Mark, close that door.
We have to leave them open.
Okay. Because you get a lot of noise.
Just open this.
That's me.
Want to talk to him?
Who was it? We're okay.
Okay. The issue that they brought up was the deficit that the Greta Fund is carrying. And they wanted they had asked me some questions. Right now, the deficit stands at around $1.4 million that needed to be addressed. And they said the unassigned fund balance would need to be reduced in the general fund to make up this deficit. If we found that those funds of the 1.4, any or all of those funds would not be reimbursable from the state. I did discuss with them that we had a new DOT director reviewing this, as well as my staff, Michelle, who's done a lot of hard work and going back to 2003, I believe. To try to see where this deficit occurred, how it occurred, and are there some costs that have not been asked for reimbursement from the state, or is it truly just non-reimbursable cost? They said that if there were some of the costs that were going to be reimbursed within this fiscal year, then they would just need written documentation that that would be coming. And for the money that would not be reimbursed, then we would, you know, need to use our general fund unassigned fund balance to make up that deficit in the Greta Fund. I'm going to kind of let Michelle kind of go into detail of what she's come up with. She spent hours on this, going through all the payments, trying to match up with all the receipts to see if she saw a pattern of what was not being reimbursed for. So Michelle, if you don't mind, if you'll just kind of talk about what you found.
Okay. The Greta Fund, in case you don't know, is a fund that was established, I believe, 2002. The county gave $1.7 million to cover operating expenses for the Greta buses. In return, we got $19+ million for road projects. There were three projects. I've completely reconciled the Lee Road Phase 1, everything expense there, preliminary engineering costs have been reimbursed. The Lee Road Phase 2 project, the fund began to run a deficit in 2012, but it was allowable because there were identified revenues that were coming back in, and as time progressed, we begin to incur some expenses that are not reimbursable. Administrative costs on oil and alkali, environmental costs, asbestos testing, things like that are not reimbursable. One project is completely reconciled, 100% reimbursable. Lee Road Phase 2, right now we've incurred $1.4 million in expenses that are not reimbursable. The third project is Jurley Lane. I'm in the process of digging through that at this time to see. Theirs was a little bit harder. We received just three lump sum checks with no documentation as to what the reimbursements were for. And the billing wasn't all done from our office. So I'm trying to put together the paperwork to reconcile that project to see if any of those expenses should be added to the 1.4. And working with Mahala to identify, I've asked her to get me the parcel numbers of condemnations. The right-of-way acquisitions for the Lee Road have all been reimbursed, except she's got a few outstanding condemnations, so we can identify a little more revenue that's going to be coming in.
Quick question. How much is the three checks that came in for Jurley?
These are very old transactions.
This one.
Okay.
And again, these are just facts. We're just discovering facts. You know?
One check was $237,000. The next one was $166,000. And then the final payment was $1.2 million.
What was the first one? Two what?
$237,393.
Yep, got it.
Then $166,086. And then $1,199,904.
That's what, about 1.4? No. Oh, yeah. How much is that total?
$1.6.
Close enough for the comps. All right, so potentially another $1.5 million from Jurley, but we know assuredly 1.4 from Lee Road Phase 2.
I'm not sure about Jurley, what portion we'll have to cover. The fund itself, the project itself does have a $300,000 deficit, but that's just expenditures as compared to the budget.
The project being Jurley.
Yes, sir. The expenditures exceeded the budget.
We ended 2017 when we did receive almost $2 million in 2018 to help the deficit, because we did end 2017 because of our fiscal year and the timing of reimbursements was with almost $3.4 million. As a deficit, but the auditors understood that we would be getting some money in. Fortunately, like within a week of me speaking with them, GDOT sent you you got the check around $1.9 million check that came in. So that drops our deficit in the fund in total of just under $1.4 million. And that is the amount that the auditors are saying that if we can't show that the reimbursements or it's reimbursable from the state or time has lapsed where it's no longer reimbursable from the state, then we would have to make that shortfall in the fund because it's not going to go anywhere. It's just going to stay there, and the place to go get it is the general fund. So it's like a true up.
Yeah, so we would just amend the budget this year. I mean, how would you reconcile it? What is the action that would be taken by finance?
The action that we would do would be our auditors. We would go back to the auditors and confirm with them or let them know that Michelle, with all of her work that she's done, it's been confirmed that the $1.4 million deficit is not reimbursable. And we would just work with the auditors and do a year-end adjustment to our books. And it would be a transfer out of the general fund, which is a fancy word for a different type of expenditure. And it would be a transfer into the Greta Fund, and it would bring that fund back to zero. But it would have an impact to our unassigned fund balance, which stands at about 12.4, so that adjustment would bring it down to 11 million.
All right, so it would not impact our capital transportation fund. Separate topic.
Yes, sir.
And this is the reason I brought this. I thought it was important to bring before this committee because it's related. I know there was a reconciliation. It was important to ensure that we're all talking in the same room, which is to avoid just to create a healthy environment going forward. I don't believe there's an action that we need to take in the transportation based on right now. This is a finance issue, but it was more courtesy, Commissioner Mulcair.
Mm-hmm.
Just we're all on the same page and sort of what needs to be done. It is a matter that comes before the full board. Mm-hmm. And so this is not really a committee recommendation, at least from transportation. Commissioner Mulcair, any?
No, I think you're on mark. You talk about a year-end reconciliation, not just going to budget amendment in July or anything like that.
It would be something that would be a 2017 year-end adjustment.
Okay, and that would satisfy the auditor?
Yes.
Yeah. And us?
Yes.
Amy, all right, so here's the... And this is what I wanted to just hear. Maybe there was a question of how we were getting invoices without any paperwork, right? That's the door lead, right? So that's one topic that I would like to know an answer. It's like, well, who authorized? How was that spawned? I know you get invoices. We're like, okay, it's an invoice. We're here to pay it. That's fine. I just like to know the authorization trail on that. That's on the door lead. And the second one has more to do with, because I'm trying to clean the books and Miguel for you going forward, you know,
yes,
like after you know the protocol, mm-hmm. you know the process, and so we'll leave it there. The second one is that as it relates to $1.4 million in reimbursable expenses or non-reimbursable mm-hmm. expenses, how much of that 1.4, and you mentioned it in our last meeting, but say it for the record, how much do we think is not reimbursable?
1.4. I've got with Miguel, and he's confirmed that more than that to bill is administrative expenses and all these other smaller,
yeah.
like legal fees in the event of a condemnation, these are non-reimbursable.
So it's a total 1.4.
Yes.
So we went from 500 yesterday. Okay, so it was 500 yesterday. Now it's a total of 1.4, and in that, okay, so these are like environmental. What is the administrative cost? Just overhead. I mean, just oversight, program management?
It was program management, program yeah. oversight with the condemnations and property acquisition. I think there was some oversight there. I think that was the bulk of the expenditure.
Okay, so it's oversight admin, that's fine, over a project that has no macro funding. This is my question. This is where I'm going. Which is, if the dollars had already expired, the grant from the state, I guess the third question is, at what point was the grant expired? Because we started running the deficit in 2012, is what I just heard. I just like to know when did that grant expire? And if that is known, where are we incurring program management expenses on what?
Okay. In 2012, we had a deficit, but it wasn't, the auditors did not want an adjustment for it because we had pending revenues that just did not come back in the first of the year. As the projects began to wind down, then and all the reimbursements were in, that's where you see the final or the deficit that needs to be covered.
And as far as your first question about the process
yep.
and everything, the Greta Fund was understood, and correct me if I'm wrong, Michelle, that it was for costs associated that were going to be 100% reimbursed. That's how we described that fund. It was 100% reimbursable. Therefore, the prior DOT director was charged with overseeing the requisitions and the purchase order, I guess requisitions, the requisitions that then get turned into purchase orders.
Yeah.
And then my staff, accounts payable, if they have an approved purchase order and an approved invoice, then they don't go so far as to look at that. They're just matching up paperwork to pay the bill. So I think where it starts is having the DOT department know that when they do a requisition to that fund or to any future fund that has 100% reimbursable, it's not to hit that fund if it doesn't meet those standards. Or make sure that the board has addressed the budget side of it prior to making that requisition or that expenditure, and that's what did not happen. When you have a $19 million capital project fund, being the Greta Fund, and requisitions are going through for studies, for project management, for right-of-way acquisition, all those costs, there should have been a check and balance with the budget to make sure the budget was there for anything that was non-reimbursable, and that did not occur.
And what were the approximate time frames on the Dear Lee and then the other payments we're talking about?
The Dear Lee payments came in in 2011, and all we received, we being financed, was a check and a couple of page summary with project totals. So we don't know what has been invoiced and what was not covered.
Okay, gotcha.
So that's why it's taking me a little bit longer to reconcile that one than the Lee rate.
Yeah, let me just offer a couple of observations. GDOT has come a long way in terms of the documentation they provide these days. They didn't always do that. In fact, it was not unusual for a check or a direct deposit to be made with very little backup information. So I can understand how that came about. Not having, and not trying to interpret what was done back then, a 100% reimbursable project from an engineering or from a transportation standpoint means no local match, okay? It doesn't mean necessarily that all expenditures are covered, and that's where the difference comes in, and so it needs to be understood and highlighted. There are some expenditures that are non-reimbursable at the federal level that translates down to the state and to the local. And a lot of that is what I saw when I was looking through the records, trying to reconcile stuff.
And we posed the question several times. I mean, I know it's kind of neither here nor there at this time, but Michelle, I posed the questions, okay, let's make sure that you're covered. What is going to be reimbursable? And I'll get with GDOT and let y'all know. I'll get with GDOT and let you know. And so now it's come down to where we are today.
I would think that at the time the requisition was made, there would have been a source of funding identified at that time. There should have been. And if it was reimbursable, then it should have been tagged as such. If not, it should have been tagged as not reimbursable. So I, not having all of the invoicing records, I can't say how much of that played out, how it played out, but that would be a source of information whether when the requisition was made, it was labeled as non-reimbursable or reimbursable. Yeah.
Would you say, Michelle, that was not then?
It was not.
And I'm a little related to this. This was more of a courtesy to come across and again to inform the other committee. I'm still back to, if the grant expired, why are we incurring expenses as an organization on something that we know that can't be fulfilled? Whether it's reimbursable or not, or are we pushing, it may be just an approach, a style, right? But I'm trying to understand, because it assumes certain things, right? There's some assumptions that are going on in that approach about the spend. And again, back to the path of condemning right away, some of this stuff precedes that of environmental. If we know the grant has expired, those funds could be redirected towards something that we know is actively in play that we can fulfill. And again, I'm not going to belabor that here, but it's just I've got to put it on the record to get a better understanding of why did we move on it then?
Let me speak to that to the extent that I'm familiar with it and have been part of it. Not all funds related to this project have expired. There are phases of the project that are still active. In fact, that's the reason we got the near $2 million reimbursement, because the right-of-way acquisition component, that funding is secure and is still active. So anything that we do related to that, to the extent that it is a reimbursable expenditure, then we should anticipate and would anticipate this reimbursement.
Okay. So it's not absolute. There are certain things we can do to move it along and ask that the state will still honor, even though, to your point, certain components of the bigger chunk, maybe, or we redirect those funds somewhere else, but the smaller soft costs and things that you may do to sort of move yourself along as government moves along, we'll work with you. Am I hearing that accurately? Mm-hmm. I think Commissioner Mulcair is just something for us to think about. Mm-hmm. I think until it comes back to the full Board of Commissioners, I don't know if there's necessarily any action you can take here other than just to listen.
It goes to Director Valentin's point about having an assigned financial analyst or something like this on the DOT side.
What we just approved?
It will tonight. I think this goes directly to that issue, is tightening up of the process and seeing if the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed as far as feds and the state are concerned, and certainly our auditors in play. So we're already taking corrective action in a sense, which is a good thing.
As we go forward, yeah. We got something on the docket tonight.
We recognize the problem.
As we go forward. So two separate issues. Going forward, Director Hallman, you two are talking. Are you aware that there's this, what is it called, a transportation analyst?
What'd you call it? What do we call it?
Transportation project analyst.
Yeah.
Yeah, that.
Something like that.
Yeah, that role is on the agenda tonight, but you're aware of its functions and that how this person perhaps filled the hole that we have once had between the two departments.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's good.
Mark?
Yes.
That's good.
Okay.
And can I also assume that nothing will be charged to the Greta Fund going forward without, one, it being reimbursable, or two, that it's been brought before the board to amend the budget to get additional funding to fund it? Because otherwise we're going to end up right where we are today.
I think there has to be a dual check.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And before, what it sounds like, you had no awareness of what the other guy was doing.
Right.
And he had to just, he was sovereign, he was just moving on his own. I'm thinking that there should be a check in that with you too. That, in other words, I'm going to leave it to you. I mean, Commissioner Mulcair, I mean, that's sort of operational to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. I think you guys are strong enough and seasoned enough to do what, we don't want to
make it work.
Right. So I don't think everything has to be overseen by the Board of Commissioners, because this is just your own structure, your own policy, your own procedures on how y'all do this. But y'all can work this out.
Mm-hmm.
With this person in the middle.
Yeah, that's exactly that. And to that point, we are instigating a tool. Be it the individual person is going to see that it gets done.
I need your agreement on this.
Yes, sir, I agree.
Okay.
I think the issue's been rectified going forward.
Right.
Previously.
Mm-hmm. Other than the money.
Yeah. It's rectified going forward procedure, but reconciliation of the money going backwards.
Yes.
But those are two different conversations.
Yep.
We're okay.
And we're going to be doing the same exact analysis with the CTF fund, making sure Michelle's worked really well with Miguel. I'm getting some answers, but there's still some of those gray areas of making sure that we have a budget, that budget included a reimbursable portion from the state. Has that, or is that funding still available? Yes or no? If it is, when does it expire? And then from an operational standpoint, who does the billing? We'll be glad to do the billing if we can get, or, we'll find a way to do that. But the same analysis is being done on the Capital Transportation Fund, because there's been projects that expenditures have been made, but we're not quite 100% sure if the reimbursement has been, or partial reimbursement has been sent to us.
And I can appreciate, and that is unfortunate because generally, before the expenditure is, before the funds are encumbered, it is known what portion of it is reimbursable.
And we know that.
At least what category.
Yeah.
And you can track that. So I foresee no issues going forward. I would like to get the information that Michelle has put together so we can try and reconcile, not reconcile, but look for any information that we may have to see if there's any other recourse. And Michelle has posed a question several times, and she's tried to get the answer from several angles, and I know what she's after. I've been couching their response because I don't give up. That's one of my traits. I don't like to get to the point where I have to say, no, that's lost money. But if there's any possibility that approaching it from a different angle, talking to a different agency, having a come to Jesus moment, that we can change the outcome, then I would want to pursue that. Mm-hmm. But my response is, this is what it looks like to me at this point. Mm-hmm. But I haven't given up yet, because if there's any other way that we can change the outcome, it's not going to be 1.4 million. But if there's any other way that there's some category, some of those activities, and it's going to take some time going back to see exactly what the scope of services was, then perhaps some of that could be salvaged. But at this point, it doesn't appear.
We have to keep time moving on this topic. We're on to our rest of our agenda. Duly noted, and I appreciate hearing that sentiment. It matches with most of the pride of the county, and especially the administration, which is, let's just do it right because it's right, and let's get it right on the first time. I think the reason we brought this before the commission, we brought it before this committee, ultimately give it to the Board of Commissioners, is that there's a time constraint from the auditor. Mm-hmm. You had all time in the world, right? When this first broke and we were in our retreat, the prior director said, this is, well, the grant is died. And I'm like, what'd you say? Like, what? And that's when it broke last year. So we've had some time, right? And so now this is something that we've asked even in this meeting. Should we dig deeper? But now you've got our big auditor has grabbed this, right? So that's a different animal. I'm not certain how much negotiation can be done, but there's an expectation for us to have a response to the plan. Mm-hmm. I think they run in parallel. You continue down your path. But at some point, she's got to make a call, meaning we've got to pony up to the auditors and say, this is where we are today. Mm-hmm. If it turns out better later after light, that's great. But we don't have the rest of the year to reconcile this.
Right.
This is this cycle right now. I'm usually what, around June or so is when we meet with our auditors, mm-hmm. mid-year. Mm-hmm. All right. Respectfully, right?
Sure.
All right. So that being said, anything else on that?
No, sir.
All right. Anything else? That was it?
That was it.
Just one item?
Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Mulcair?
Good.
Mark, I'm going to release her.
Yes, sir.
Ladies, thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Not yet, sorry. I'm going to move around, though. All right, anything else, Mark, we needed to add when we were talking? Just, we're good?
We're good.
All right, so... let's go ahead and get into the agenda. Let's move on to our next item. Let me just check real quick. We do have a special guest here that's going to, Gary Watson is not here. Are y'all prepared to talk about Douglas Connect? Mark? Miguel?
Yes, again.
Okay, just as a top level. Let me do that first, move it around, and we can release her and we can get into the rest of this. That Mark, you okay?
Okay.
Commissioner Walker?
Good.
And we can just keep this moving. Okay, and this, again, without Gary being here, I'm just going to preface what I was trying to accomplish with this, having this as an update. And I want to respectfully give him time to report on this, if that makes sense. So there's no hard inquiry. What we have before us, though, is one of the things that we're committed to as far as our consultant was to sort of begin to frame a timeline for us. over the next 90 days. What does it look like as it relates to scope of work, community engagement moments, events like that? And I've asked them to be here to just sort of walk through this first pass. It's a framework. This is just presenting how they think, their approach and their methodology, the actions. These are their thoughts and stuff. So this is not just it's not an adoption moment, but it's just more of us to let's get all on the same page. Ultimately, this schedule will be extended, you know, through the rest of the year in the event that we are able to get there. But this represents the scope of work for the next 90 days. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Can you just walk us through how you structured this and the tasks associated?
Certainly. And I also have another handout that elaborates the tasks that have transpired thus far and during the first phase.
And your name and who for the record, because we're filming this.
Good afternoon. My name is Danielle Cronin. I'm the Director of Communication and Community Engagement at the Collaborative Firm. And as you all know, we were secured to lead the efforts for rebranding for Connect Douglas, as well as public input for some of the services that will be added. Prior to the kickoff, our kickoff meeting, with Gary Watson, who is the Rideshare Multimodal Service Director, Mr. Bill Peacock, and Miguel Valentin from DOT. We had a kickoff meeting to get a consensus on the deliverables, the scope of work, the expectations, and a proposed timeline. After that meeting, that's when this proposed timeline was developed, and it was used to as a supporting document to draft the contract. It is, there are moving targets on here, but it gave us a framework from which to work and to have some agreement on level of expectation. The handout that I just provided gives an overview of some of the activities that we have done in this initial phase. The initial phase of this campaign is assessment. As we stated in our proposal, we have to research and really glean what are the expectations, what are our patrons' current perceptions, and the getting insight from our elected officials and departmental leaders as well. So one of the first things was the kickoff meeting that I've initially shared. Next, we had a SWOT analysis work session that I conducted with Gary and his team. All of those participants are listed there. And from there, we reviewed the current marketing materials and really just tried to assess what strengths and weaknesses currently existed and what opportunities and threats may exist relative to developing messaging. Next, we conducted a van pool focus group. And forgive me, I can see a little something there, but that was with the van pool riders I actually gained firsthand experience. I did a reverse commute from Atlanta, rode a route to see what that experience was like. And so when we say we meet people where they are, we don't just say that in our interview or proposal stage. That's what we do. Oftentimes people say we can't get information from people who actually utilize the service. Well, get on the service. That's where they are. So I rode in the van pool and was able to speak with people who had been riding for 20 years and people who were new to get their insight. How did they receive the communication? Was the information accessible? How is it being communicated to them? So I'm getting firsthand accounts. Additionally, we had a kickoff meeting with Commissioner Robinson, myself, along with the managing partner of the collaborative firm, Mr. Michael Hightower, to gain Commissioner Robinson's insight on the overall process, as well as the Commissioner for District 2, what are the preferences for his constituents in terms of public engagement. And we plan, that's on next steps. We're in the scheduling process to do that with Chairman Jones, as well as all the other commissioners, Commissioner Mulcair, and we're working with Sherry Mathis and Javine to get those items scheduled. Lastly, on today, I also had a focus group for participants that utilized the transportation voucher program. There were current patrons who were senior citizens, as well as have some challenges, mobility challenges. So I spoke to them about their experiences. And from that, I'm trying to glean different
themes and recurring themes of what the ride share or the services mean to them and how we can utilize that to connect with other people. So our next steps in this same phase, as I said, is continuing on with our district insight listening sessions with the other elected officials. And then lastly, within this first phase that's scheduled for this week, is a branding strategy session with the directors of external affairs and communications and community relations. Our goal is not to put something out there for Connect Douglas that's that counters the overall communication plan for Douglas County. We want to make sure that it's aligned and in tune with the current messaging for the county. And that's it in a nutshell.
Okay, cool. Commissioner Walker. Mm-hmm. Versus Senate. I appreciate it.
Question for you. Two quick questions. And I appreciate your comments about meeting with external affairs and communications. There is and this is more of a put this out there for you to go inquire with, and especially with these two that you're going to meet with, is that there's a broader branding exercise that's going on outside the county. And it's not outside the county, it's outside government. In other words, it's the broader community, this is broader marketing strategy through our commerce, Chamber of Commerce. Commissioner, you know what I'm talking about? The broader.
Yeah, I'm trying to put a name on it.
That strategic plan.
They mentioned it a couple times today.
And it's, no, we're participating in it. We're not necessarily driving, if that makes sense. This is government proper. Two separate worlds. And it's like, okay, let's make sure they're aligned. Because while that civic engaged group were meeting in all their different pods, marketing, economic development, they had all these little sections. One of my constituents who was on the committee said, Commissioner Robinson, why isn't transportation part of the branding exercise with this? Why are we talking about branding and transportation is not one of the elements of government that we're... I think, good point. Can you make sure you double back and make sure that while you're talking to our side, that's a key component that needs to be aligned, and that could be a good vehicle for you to go back across or vice versa? Because there is work that's already being done. It was one question we even asked while we're here, is that a duplication? We recognize that this required its own attention, and it's always been budgeted, but it's just one of those, let's not get it out of sync. All right. The second thing I had, and I'm going to keep moving on this, was your branding. Your kickoff meetings. Meeting with the commissioners. When do you plan on meeting? What was the goal on this?
The goal for meeting with the commissioners was actually this week. We attempted scheduling that in early April. So we've had some scheduling challenges. Of course, we understand that commissioners have...
Are you trying to meet them as a group, or are you just trying to grab them?
Individually.
Okay, all right.
Individually.
Okay. All right. We'll do the best you can, but just try to get their participation and get their input, but you gotta stay on schedule.
Yes, it's essential, especially since we committed to district-specific, customized public engagement, and so we need those leaders' input to do that.
Commissioner, okay, will you be around in next week or so?
Next week, yeah, but,
Next week, I said.
Not this week.
Yeah, you're good. I said. Okay, last question was dealing with, as you capture this information, as you capture this, no, more about it, I'll get you what I'm talking about.
I got three.
As you capture information from citizens, how are you codifying it? Because at some point, someone may say, we can tell great stories. And it's just for us collecting. We can tell great stories and we can say this is what our experience was. But to have the raw, rich feedback, how will you cap this? How do you encapsulate it and put it somewhere that for future use, future reference, future whatever, the raw data?
The raw data. Well, these focus groups are qualitative exercises that we're conducting at this time. And they're kept at a very intimate level to elicit more information and have people be comfortable.
Candid.
Very candid. And, but there will be other efforts as well, but I wanted to meet with External Affairs and Community Communications Department, because there is a plan also to launch an electronic survey where we can get and quantify that information and aggregate it. Nevertheless, from a branding standpoint, sometimes it's easier to get those themes from that qualitative data and from the intimate information. But we will have summaries available, and within our overall communication plan, those will be referenced.
Okay. All right. Yeah, that's because something you highlighted in times past as far as, you know. Yeah. All right. This schedule that you gave us, this is just a for us to take a look at it. We don't have to necessarily walk through this. You give us what you've done today.
Yes.
But is this something that we'll use as a guide to begin to frame how we keep on track?
Yes. So all of the efforts that were listed, that I listed going through this handout, are actually in the first phase, which is project assessment. Across the border is the projected weeks. But of course, all of those are predicated upon people's availability and scheduling. A point of reference I'd like to highlight is that we have weekly updates and either conference calls or in-person meetings with Gary Watson, the director, and our direct person who we are working with, as well as we're trying to get all of this information in the assessment phase done quickly, because the branding has to happen prior to the public engagement and education portion. So we have to have all those materials, the communication plan developed, and the actual brand in place and collaterals developed in May before we launch and start the campaign.
So all of May, and then you the actual will be what, 2 months thereafter, or whatever the last time period is.
Yes.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to regroup my comments, and I'll close this out. We'll move on to our next topic, which is as you lay out this plan, which is one of the things that, and this is background for you, and this is where you're going to, for the most part, the Transportation Committee has taken its time and its approach to this transportation. We've probably made about 8 key decisions since 2 years ago. All important, but never, it's sort of steady. And we used the CMAQ grant process as a, what we call pre-qualifying for a loan, right? Let's should we be pre-qualified, right? Before we get into formal action. As we get closer to perhaps that impending, I won't call it life event, we'll say business event, a formalized program management approach or planning has to be in place, a schedule, not just for our own internal works, but for our constituents. There has to be some, I mean, in our mind, and I grew up in program management, I can model in my mind, I can count in my own mind because of my own skill sets. But that's great for my position where I sit. But as it relates to the whole team, we need a tool. And so we think that, Miguel, and I want you to say, or validate without Gary being here, is that this is important for us to have some type of tool that lays out a schedule. And the reason I say that is I want to look at Athens Clark County, the base of your website. It lays out all their plans, all their communication, everything you just said, it's there. Now, obviously, our scope of work does not, that we have for a collaborative, is not this.
It is not.
All right, we understand that. But there can be a framework.
Yep.
That as we move forward and we go deeper, as once we become qualified for the program, then we can talk about this. But for right now, there has to be some tool in which we measure that we can set expectations and be accountable for on how we're moving forward.
Sure.
What do you think?
No, absolutely. And I think this is a fairly good guide. Right now, it's pretty simple graphic, but there's a lot behind all of these strategies and the next steps that would allow us to track where we are and where we're headed.
If I may,
yes.
As well, once we get to plan development, this, as I stated, we're in the assessment phase and the research phase. That data, both qualitative and quantitative, will be utilized to develop the communication plan. Within the communication plan, we're going to have our specific targets, there will be schedules, and there will be measurable and specific goals. This campaign will have to be approved before we implement it. So I think that you will see a lot of those measures which strategies are being employed and why they are being, the rationale behind the selection within the communication plan itself. This is just the necessary steps that have to happen before we develop it.
And again, I want to make sure we caveat that there's basically four functions of transportation, multimodals, that we currently operate, which is to re-educate the community on what we've already got. And then the fifth one, which is this fixed route, is just an additional service offering. So I don't want to get confused that this is strictly about a bus service rollout. There's a broader education. You're clear on what that
is. I am very clear.
Okay. Miguel, did that?
Yes, sir.
Because Gary's not here, I'm just making sure that that's what we understand. Mm-hmm. All right, Commissioner Volker, I'm going to wrap this up because this was just sort of an introduction to our first. I invited Danielle here to sort of begin. You serve being at the table, at least for the next 90 days. You're welcome here, and that's all we need for you tonight now.
Thank you.
Commissioner Volker?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. All right. Let's keep going. All right, Miguel, I'll let you take over.
Yes, sir.
Hit it.
Thank you very much, Chairman. The next item that I'd like to address, we have another guest here that I'd like to get back. He does have other commitments,
yep.
And I appreciate his indulgence. And
yep.
We have the Lee Road Small Area Plan scope. Initially, was defined as you know, as a small area. Well, after discussions at various levels with the Development Authority and internally, it's become pretty obvious to us that we need to not just be looking at that small area, but the remainder of that corridor.
Okay.
And we're looking at the study area as being just that, a corridor, not a specific, certainly it's going to have a node in the middle of the small area itself. But what we're looking to do is to have a component of the study, the scope expanded to include the rest of the corridor from I-20 down to Fairburn Road, and then on the other side, the potential extension down to all the way to Chapel Hill.
Right.
And potential beyond. I've looked at the comprehensive plan, and certainly there are other components that take it much further beyond. But initially, as we look at it from a transportation standpoint, you have to develop what are referred to as logical termini, places where you can take traffic and move it from one location to the other. And even if you were to develop the corridor in phases, you still have to look and analyze it as a composite. And so therefore, the committee has gone back to the consultant and gotten a proposal to expand the services to include both of those areas. And I think the estimate, and this is what we would like to be able to move back forward to the.
Let me make sure I get it. Commissioner Volker, this is when I first came on board. This has been 2009. Commissioner Volker was driving economic development and transportation for all intents and purposes for the county. And Commissioner Volker, for the record, can you talk about the very first thing you exposed me to was this notion of the ARC. Mm-hmm. The outer arc.
Yeah, the southern.
Can you introduce that one more? Just frame that for us so we can have it, just for history's sake, that we understand what that was. Because, again, this is 9 years later. We're just now.
Yeah. So thus goes transportation planning.
Right.
We've seen, you know, the evidence of this initiative with the Lee Road expansion, the interchange right there at I-20, and then the land acquisition and active planning and going down to Fairburn Road. It's not only, to me, it's very much a transportation project and a economic development project at the same time. They most always are at the same time, but this is really a serious one for Douglas County in both of those two venues. First one is transportation, in fact, to relieve all of these north-south
columns of traffic, be it Highway 5, Chapel Hill Road, Fairburn Road, and so forth, having to go into the densest part of the county, which is Douglasville periphery and core, to get on the interstate. So that means people living where I do down on 166 have to go through Douglasville, you know, to get on the interstate. So that's the transportation issue. And what this ARC can do is provide an alternate for people to avoid going into the core of our population density, i.e. Douglasville. For that matter, you know, we're not just necessarily talking about people in the south going to the north and getting on this ARC. We're talking about people in the north, say the southern part of the density, the population density of Douglasville, being able to go south and get on this ARC and not have to go through the mall traffic and you know, and so forth. Example might be our Arbor Station or, you know, some of those others not have to go through the up Chapel Hill Road to get on this ARC. So that's, and taking it to its obvious fulfillment at some point in the future, I mean, it would extend all the way to I-20 on the west side of Douglasville. But I'm sensitive, I understand what you're saying. I don't think there's many transportation projects that don't go in increments. And the appropriate next increment to me would be Fairburn Road to Chapel Hill Road, very, very clearly obvious. The second part, we talk about economic development, is the potential for that area. It's large expanses of unbuilt out property between Fairburn Road and Chapel Hill Road, kind of hidden behind subdivisions, hidden behind Beaumont Road and Fairburn Road and places like that. And the opportunity there to develop that corridor between Fairburn Road and Chapel Hill Road, not just house rooftops, but real mixed use and commercial development. You know, doctor's offices, corporate headquarters, retail, and so forth. So I think it could be internally generated. You know, we're talking about Switch and tremendously the opportunity there, this kind of externally generated. This is a huge engine that Douglas County can initialize and energize the community internally. Would be this southern arc. And so yeah, Commissioner Robinson and I have had quite a few conversations about it probably from day one about the importance of both as a transportation remediation and then as a commercial development driver, huge commercial development driver.
No, and I appreciate that. And just for the record, we have a guest. Can you just put the record for the building?
Ron Roberts, Planning Design Manager.
Okay. And again, economic development in essence, you're represented for the planning and mm-hmm. as well as for transportation. Mm-hmm. Appreciate that, Commissioner Mulcair, to sort of bridge that. There's some historical that we bought into. Mm-hmm. And you guys need to hear it straight from the horse in essence and take that's where we're going. So, what would you like us to do?
Absolutely. To that end, we would like a recommendation from the committee to the board that we engage the same or expand the services of the existing Clark Patterson Lee consultant to include the entire corridor from I-20 all the way to Chapel Hill Road.
All right, so for me, just for my simple, all right, so I've got this little map, and there's a circle, which is the area, right? And if I come this way, it's Lee Road, in theory, right?
Correct.
This way, we're going to Chapel Hill, right?
You see that is correct.
This is true, but I'm doing the best I can.
Yes, that's pretty good, actually.
Are we going, when we say the corridor, we're not talking about the whole expanse, we're just saying straight from the circle back to the highway. What are we saying?
We're talking about from this, the entire from Chapel Hill. Now, keep in mind that, well, let me expand the description a little bit. The small area study looked at the extension of Lee Road, which was a very limited area.
Which is a 200-acre area, I think.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And as we began to look at that area, we realized that this corridor needed to project eventually, not necessarily the same character as that small area, but eventually as a transportation corridor, it would need to extend down to Beaumont Road and then eventually to Chapel Hill. So what we're mm-hmm. suggesting is that not to limit the study area to that small area, but to expand it again just along a corridor. So this would take in perhaps a swath, maybe 200-300 feet on either side of the road itself.
Mm-hmm. Right, so it moved from maybe to be a sort of a site study to a corridor study.
To a corridor study. Mm-hmm.
Correct. So so again, I did not hear this, but to clarify, we're not just talking about back to I-20 Lee Road. We're talking about all the way through.
All the way through.
But a road that has not been cut yet. We're going all Commissioner Mulcair, all the way across.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we already got somebody in play, and so what are we doing? Just amending. So I'm not assuming anything. The source of funding for this is what, going to tie it to economic development, just part of the SPLOST, as we've done with the current money?
That's correct.
Okay, I want to make sure that I don't see this as a capital transportation fund on this one. I think this is Commissioner Mulcair.
It's economic development, big time.
Okay. All right.
Quality economic development.
All right, so what is the amount that we're being, I mean, what, was $75,000, $150,000 is normally what these studies are going for? Are we amending? Are we, this is a bigger area. Are we being asked to amend, or is this a new contract? Like, what are we really stating?
We're asking to amend the existing contract and for an amount, an additional $74,650 to include that entire group.
But what's the current study cost?
It's about $75,000.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we get the whole corridor,
mm-hmm,
that's right, for the same price as doing just that 200-acre site? Commissioner Mulcair?
No, it'd be twice.
It'd be twice, yeah. Be the,
yeah, 75 plus 75.
Plus 75.
Yeah, but we already paid the 75, right?
Correct, yeah. There's,
and we're just in a meeting agreement for the rest of this work, right?
Correct.
So not
for 75.
Which is very similar to the price we paid for the Thorn Road study. I think that was 160,
yeah, one,
something,
mm-hmm,
okay, somewhere in that range.
Okay. Duly noted.
Sure.
Manager, Roberts, do you have anything you want to add before we call an action here?
No, it sounds like it's covered pretty well.
Okay. You don't have to belabor it, Commissioner.
I make a motion to approve the amended agreement for expansion of services and,
yes,
for the Lee Road extension.
To confirm, but was
to recommend to the board, or
yes,
to approve the,
yeah, amend the agreement with Clark Patterson Lee for expanding the scope of work to include a corridor study terminus at Chapel Hill Road.
Let me ask a question. Mm-hmm. This is important. Who's driving this? Economic development or us? The reason I ask that, if it's economic development, is this more of an administrative concurrence? In other words, they were given $10 million as part of the SPLOST. No real programming was in it, but then they had authority to do so. I can't remember how this original site plan was blessed. In other words, did it come before us, or was it over there with them?
Yes, so technically, that $10 million was not given to the Development Authority. It's, yeah, it's in our SPLOST. Yeah. We have control over it.
I'm saying.
This project was recommended by this committee, I believe, and but the board approved the contract for $75,000.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Right. The as stated. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then, at the Commissioner Mulcair, as you stated.
Yes.
All right. Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor of approving the amendment of the Clark Patterson site plan study to become a corridor study as suggested by our planning zoning manager and our Department of Transportation in the amount not to exceed $75,000.
Aye.
All in favor? All opposed? Most carried.
Now we need to get that on the agenda.
Got
board commissioner's agenda to be paid for as SPLOST.
Yeah, that's exciting. Really, it's really good work that they've been doing, and look forward to sharing it.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay.
All right. I think it's one of the most important things out there, the support.
Yep. We're finally getting there. At least we got a study. They ain't got a road. My bad. Okay.
And I would say to Mr. Chairman,
yes,
to the sensitivity of the full commission, is this something that we want to delay 2 weeks until the next meeting, or surprise them with it tonight. You see what I'm saying?
Would you agree that, was this already a broke some kind of way? Was this?
No, I was thinking in terms of next meeting, not tonight.
Yes.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dean. No shotgun necessary. There's no time pending, no constraint. We'll lose the land, we'll lose the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Initiative is there.
I'll let you bring forth when necessary based on...
Okay, we'll bring it next meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
Good.
Thank you, Dean.
I'll at least do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ron. All right. Miguel, keep moving.
Yes, sir, Charlie. Next is an update on the roadside mowing contract. Now, we put a request for proposals out and got three proposals back. And one of the bidders was last year's contractor. And they were, in fact, the lowest bid. However, it is my understanding, and you'll have to excuse my lack of direct knowledge to some of these things, but I just wouldn't hear it. So,
yep.
But I understand that that there were some performance issues that have been reported, and so there was a concern about which particular contractor to go with. The extent of the issues that were reported, the performance deficiencies, have been fairly voluminous.
Yep.
But I think it would be worth to have a discussion as to whether that what would be something that would necessarily get us to go to a different contractor. Just again, I don't know. I cannot offer a recommendation on that element because I'm not directly aware.
All you have is the numbers in front of you.
Correct.
Yeah. Do you wish it?
Certainly.
Mm-hmm. Right. So you have a copy, and we can. This was a topic the majority, if not all, the commissioners had some type of opinion or position on performance out there. We got a lot of criticism from the public about cutting, keeping us clean, which is some of the broader initiatives you see, Madam Chair, initiating, you know, keep Douglas clean, volunteers, etc. There was some question regarding this, and so this is more of a how do we move forward. There was some desire to break this up, a contract up between the four commission districts. Just because what happened was there was this context that we put rainy days aside, and in the spring and the summer and the grass goes back faster, there was just no perceptual, no optics to say there was anything being done. And while you concentrated in one area, the other four commission district or three commissions weren't being taken care of, right? It was too small of a crew. So I guess my question with all of this is that what's being proposed is to fulfill this strategy. In your opinion, now that part you probably can answer, which is you got this one contract that's supposed to take care of everything. Is there sufficient cutting frequency and skill of operations to fulfill the general expectations that each commission district wanna, it's almost like the resurfacing. They wanna see their, at some point you need to get to us, right? I mean, we don't care what point you start. I mean, we just know at the end of the day, I know my role was cut, my role was resurfaced. You get the point.
Absolutely, and that's an easy question for me. The answer is no. The contract as it is configured, or the proposal, the request for proposal, as it's configured this year, is less than it was last year, and last year was insufficient based on the feedback to meet the level of expectation of one or more of the commission districts. So the frequency of mowing under last year's contract was approximately every couple of months. So you can imagine you mow along the road and you don't come back for 2 months, or the grass is going to get tall, the weeds are going to get even taller. So the mowing frequency just is not there. Now, a lot of these corridors can go a while, perhaps. They might be able to go a month, maybe 5 weeks or so, and without too much of a concern. But there are others that require a lot more frequent maintenance. And
which are like what? Like?
Well, corridors that either have a higher volume of traffic or that are more urbanized in some sections. Chapel Hill, for example.
That's a more frequent cut or less frequent cut?
That you would want a more frequent cut.
Okay.
But the contract didn't provide for it last year, and it doesn't provide for it this year.
Is it because of residential, we would want to have it more frequently cut versus something that was more commercial like Thornton Road?
The expectation is if you have a lot more residential subdivisions and the like, they tend to maintain that more like if it were their yard. And the expectation is that the rest of the road ought to look like that.
When I come up with subdivision, it needs to be consistent.
Yeah, the level of of mowing that we contracted for last year was nowhere near what it would take. So to answer your question, no. There isn't enough in the contract now. Now, we have, as a result of, and I thank the commission for this, we did get some additional personnel that we would have the ability to go in and mitigate certain areas, but not as a wholesale mowing component. For example,
surgical or spots.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. The as much as the area that the length of roads that would be under contract are a little less than 300 miles. We mow the same amount in-house with our own forces. We mow other roads. In other words, this contract does not address all of the county roads. It is a select subset of the entire county. So our mowing operation is encumbered doing the same amount of work elsewhere. With the additional staff, we'd be able to come back in and do and address spot locations to bring them up to speed. But
staff and equipment. So we've got the equipment.
We've got the equipment, and we got some of the staff as well.
We had other staff, but
it's right.
So they quit. Listen, we're still working on the staff.
It's operational.
Well, I'll be looking for a job in January. So.
Okay.
I can drive a bush hog.
Fours. That works. It is Fours. Greenville, Alabama. Wait, to that point, Commissioner Mulcair. Do we do it ourselves? We had this conversation very, very robustly. You might not have been here, but we had the conversation. It was because we all care, each commission district. So this wasn't a criticism. It was one of those, how do we make this better? Do we need to increase it? We had Colson, remember Mitchell, Mr. Mitchell, $1 million. We were going higher because we knew that, everybody was dissatisfied. We were landing on dissatisfaction for different reasons, but we all landed on the same reason. It was one of those times where we all like, we all agree. So it does sound like you don't feel comfortable what you're looking at. If you're not comfortable, not to award this one. He's like, it's less than, I hear you. I already know where you're, I hear it. Commissioner Mulcair, what do you,
First of all, I don't think this is adequate, and I think Director Valentin's comments are very focused in that you don't want to say you want to cut the whole county four times in a season, because you might want to cut some areas. I would say, for example, maybe very rural areas with just a lot of woods and stuff, maybe three times is adequate. Maybe Chapel Hill Road is five times. So I think the program has to be customized more than what this allows, what this supports. Now, what is that money amount? I don't know. I suspect it's going to be more than this. Now, to your question about in-house, long-range planning, and assuming we can hire people, I'd like to see us transition, and that needs to be part of this consideration of this contract, where we have these people cut, is over time. I'd like to see the county taking in more of the responsibility, kind of controlling their own destiny, and having the responsiveness to say, Bullmore Road somebody dropped out, you know, three bags of garbage and they need to be picked up and the grass cut. And if you got, if you're relying on a contractor to do that, well, I'll get to it, and I think I can get to it in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, that kind of thing. So I think to a degree we need to start controlling our own destiny. But this contract needs to be modified.
I don't want to lose your frame of thinking. Are we saying, and I want to clarify, this does include pickup? Meaning, yes, there's mowing and there's a, in other words, you have to pick the trash up before you cut the bag of trash.
I'm just asking.
Yeah. You know, if there was a crew that comes and preps, you know, and, you know, like, roll surface. You know, there's somebody has to go out there first and get it ready, and then there's another team that does the heavy lifting. But you're saying it does include appropriate.
Mm-hmm. All right. It does.
Do we, and again, I don't think this is like resurfacing where there's an equal amount. It's wherever the need is on this one, mm-hmm. Commissioner Mulcair. You know, my district is less needed versus some other district. I think it's optics. Where do we need to concentrate? But I think it is a recommendation. My last point is, should this be in-house? And County Administrator, you and I, we had conversations with the guys over in Carroll County, and at least I know I had a site visit over there to look at a fire station, whatever, and they were telling us that they have it from sun up to sundown, in-house staff. They just go year-round. It just goes, just they sun up to sundown, they got a team, and see, those guys like to do it. We give them the best equipment, we'll let them do what they do. Now, I think, I'm not a master gardener, I'm sensitive to like, what's the, so you're really hearing a like, okay, so what should we do? This is insufficient. I can't see going to the full board of commissioners, so we should be able to figure this one out. What should we do?
Well, let me offer this, Chairman. We certainly need to have mowing services to handle that in the short term, to handle the 280 miles of roads. I would rather have three cycles to mow those roads with now than to not move forward and try to either rebid the contract or what have you. There isn't anything precluding us from potentially moving forward with the three cycles, and then while in a parallel effort trying to get additional resources or additional mowing cycles to augment if funding allows.
And we do already have the crew, but that was part of what we discussed during the budget.
How many people?
Four people plus equipment.
So we have four equipment in-house. And what is this contract? What's the relative size of it?
300,000.
I know, but what's the team? I'm trying to compare teams. So they got equipment. How many people they got running? How many teams? What does that look like? Did we just reset? I mean, I hear you. And I hear the fact that we got to augment with our own staff, because this as is going backwards. And it doesn't seem like, what are we doing? Like, you're going to get worse. You can't expect this solution to do better than what it was deficiency last year.
If I could impart some of my observation, and I'm thinking in terms of this crew that cuts for the state on 166, okay. And it goes to your question about manpower.
Yep.
That crew comes out and it's not like having an inmate crew where you got six guys gaggled together, walking together, and they got a guard watching them. They drop these guys out for miles and miles apart. So at one time, you got six or seven guys that are walking 2 or 3 miles picking up trash. So there's an efficiency there.
Okay.
But I doubt they're paid the same thing as the guys that operate the zero-turn mowers or the bush hogs.
Okay.
And then they got another kind of crew that comes along with the brush cutters and cleans up along the edge of the woods, along the signposts and everything else. They do a meticulous job. The contractor we experienced last year, it was just kind of like come in and bush hog and get as close as you can to the fence or the tree or the sign or whatever, and you know, and that was it. And sometimes they would pick up the trash and sometimes they wouldn't. My point being is the cross structure for what the contractor can do and what he can recruit and pay people for is probably going to be more cost effective than I think with the county. We're not going to hire somebody that's just going to pick up trash, or somebody that's just going to operate, you know, a brush cutter, that kind of thing. We're going to hire a road crew, and those four guys are pretty much going to be qualified to do everything. Is that an accurate statement?
Yeah.
So operationally, we have to figure out how we can make that work, you know, within the constraints of a county budget. And that's why I think it may take a little bit of time. Now, you know, maybe you could maybe create a new classification of people that don't operate heavy equipment, that is a road crew. So they would pick up trash and they could operate a brush cutter, but you're not going to let them on a bush hog. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe that's an approach, but that's going to take a little time, I think, to develop. So that's my two cents. I don't know if I've clarified anything, but I think your point is we need to go ahead and go forward with this, and I think the solution, you know, for this year, and the solution is I don't know if it's a warrant. I don't know if we documented the complaints. That first of all, is this our past year contractor?
Yeah.
Okay, the low contractor here was a guy that we were dissatisfied with last year. I don't know that we're in a position to deny them if we don't have good documentation of issues and complaints and what they've done to correct the issue, if anything. My inclination is to think that no, we kind of complain within ourselves. And
it's more,
yeah,
proceed.
Yeah, yeah, without actual documentation. I mean, I could show you a place on Chapel Hill Road where it looked like they just cut it with a swing blade, you know, had triangle right there, and it was atrocious. But they considered that done, completed. Now, I didn't document it, so I'm not blaming you or anybody else. I didn't document it, and I doubt there's been any documentation to their performance. So I think we're going to be stuck with at least this year with our past contractor.
Here, okay, so we weigh in on this. We got emails that came in, and primarily Madam Chair was receiving them, you know, to at least clean up this place, right? These were open input meetings, comments that came for these, the county administrator. You know, we went round and round with Madam Chair about this experience, because we all were weighing in and said, we from our own optics. So while we didn't have documentation, as the elected official, your word is the documentation. If you saw, like, look, y'all ain't, there's no proof. So we're looking to the administration to prove that you did something, right? It's like, no, we don't have to prove that it was a complaint. We saw there was no performance or that it wasn't what we expected. The onus is on the guy who's getting paid. We had the same conversation, remember, Madam Dyer talked about riding around that 1,000 acres and stuff, cutting up, you know, we talked about, okay, that's did by the sheriff. There was a lot that went into this. This is not, so I'm not comfortable going to the full board as if last year did not happen. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of conversations. We were like, okay, Mark, break this contract up with four people. Mark, like, okay, let's hold off. Let's wait to the end of the year. Okay, so we've gone through this, right? So it's like, no, I'm not delusional. You know, I can't see, but I'm not delusional. And so it's one of those where, come on, guys, we got to do better. They're only asking us, can you at least cut the grass? And we're acting like this is so difficult. So while we're anxious, I mean, so we're not obligated to this person here, seeing that there was truly a performance deficiency. The fact that there was conversation, the fact that, well, you know, kind of Mr. asked us to hold off and, well, let's wait to the end of the year, let's let the length make it through, and before you break it up, we may not get the same results. You know, it was like $400,000, so $100,000 per district. You probably would say that's not sufficient. You two will probably agree on that. And so I'm saying we're regressing, right? We're going the wrong way. We need to be going up, and we really want it to be pristine. Why are we perpetrating? We spend $100 million on a jail. We put money where we want to put it in an animal shelter. $5 million. Look how great this is. Can we at least cut the grass to the same standard? And it's just grass cutting. And it's like we look like we're trying to do the hookup. And I don't see the allegation where I've got to go with a guy that was poor performance last year. He fulfilled his contract. You put it out there. I still don't think that this is my argument was that this is not sufficient frequency based on what I just heard. It's insufficient. Everything the two arguments you just argued, insufficient and it's not enough scale. Well, then we got to do over. But I think we do over with the supplement that I'd like to see as a plan from you. But we're taking consideration this amount of money and your new staff. And what does that look like for us? So what would it, does that now, do we go to 10? I mean, we're just giving away this contract. It seems like we're just giving away a contract to somebody and there's no real performance. We're not holding them accountable. I mean, that's what we were, our sentiments last year was just, okay, who get this contract that we protected that, like, okay, they not doing nothing. We giving you 400 grand. I think we went from 300 to 485. We almost doubled the contract last year to get even a less performance. Here we are in a full new cycle now. We're about to start this back up. Like, no, come on.
Let me offer an observation, Chairman. At 400,000 for four cycles, the county was getting a bargain. Because in my experience, the going rate for that is probably twice what you were paying. The state unit pricing on that is about, it would have been about $1 million to do what you were being charged $400,000 to do.
Okay, so stay with me. So here's the question, which is, but it's $408,000. It wasn't meeting the expectation. So you said four cycles for $400,000, but we didn't see, you saw no material cutting. This is back to the wisdom we got from our peers over Caroline. He said, no, that thing has to run all the time. When you try to do this one area, and you go down to another district, and you go down to, with rain, with everything else, there has to be a constant flow, right? So this is not like, it's like my hair. I got to keep going every 2 weeks or this thing is going to pop. When you resurface, you can have a very structured, very fixed type of approach, right? We lay it and we go. This is not, because this is organic, it wasn't sufficient. So I'm thinking that the frequency is just, we're not hitting it enough. You're hearing it one time and say we did four cycles, we went through, but you're not hitting it enough. Like you said, sun up to sun down, so how do you get us there? That's all I'm saying, that the price is the price. If the public's expectation is that they want a smooth thing, they want what they want, then that's the price. But don't try to, you're paying money to somebody just to, like, the expectations are not being met. Our expectations are not being met.
Well, Chair, part of the answer in the Director Valentin has alluded to is cutting some areas more frequently, not going with the blanket, three times a year or four times a year. We have to recalibrate. We have to go six or seven times per year in some places, and maybe some places can go two or three times a year. I don't know. I don't have it. But there's some costs. I would think there'd be some, cost savings, even for the contractor, maybe not. But I think that's got to be part of the solution, not just a blanket four times a year. Because to your point, Chairman, that's not adequate by the time you cycle back around.
Especially with all the rain we had last year.
Mm-hmm.
So, 2 weeks later, it could be 18 inches high.
Yeah.
So, again, to your opening comments, these are just numbers. And before we take action, I know we need to get started, but can you take some time to make a pause and hear what we're saying? It says, okay, we got it. Is there a better solution? We don't have to act on this, but we can just duly note it. It's here.
I understand. Let me offer one more thing. Of the three bids, you have the previous contractor, and then you have the next low bid.
Yep.
Is an outfit that's located, operates out of Tennessee, somewhere near north of Toccoa, north of Asheville, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question is, well, if you do not have a comfort level with the previous contractor, then do you go to the second contractor who operates from out of state and is reaching, hundreds of miles to get the equipment here, and they're going to have a schedule. They would hit the areas, the roads that we ask them to, per the list, and then they're gone. And if there's something that's left that is not up to our standards or what have you, or trash somewhere, we got to go get them where they are. you know, the next bidder of the three is an outfit out of Smyrna, I believe. They operate out of, so they're not Douglas County, but they're a little more local. So the question is really, when you look at the issue, were the performance deficiencies experienced last year due to poor performance, lack of performance, or was it really that the program was not geared to the county's expectations? The frequency wasn't there. So if you would have had the same individual, the same outfit back more frequently, would that have taken care of the issue?
You increased the money, that's my whole point. We didn't, we lowered the 200,000 unit mark. I mean, we did give money to try to get it, but I get your point, and I think one of the overrides is that we want local. I mean, if I'm sitting up here giving away a mowing contract, somebody out of state, I need to join him, I'm tired. I can't support, I would be against, you know, I get it, we can put that as a condition, I'm just giving you from my perspective. Come on, guys. Surely somebody's like doing the sidewalks, right? Like surely that somebody can do this, right? And I think that's our whole premise is that with this FLOSS, the expectation was that, okay, this was supposed to be. Right. Is this FLOSS or is it operation money?
It's operation.
It's operation. All right. The spirit of just the overall sentiment is can we look for local, at least if not within our county? Can we go within at least the region before we start giving contracts out of state for stuff that truly is not mm-hmm. single source?
And that would be entirely within your prerogative.
Commissioner Wilkins, does that make sense? So I'm not discounting what you're
Carol
saying.
Carol calling, I mean, we could, you know.
Right, neighbor, yeah.
But let me ask you your specific question. What I saw in terms of their performance was below standard. They could cut the grass yesterday, and I would drive by, and it looked like it was done with a swing blade here and there.
Okay. That's the missing a lot of missing spots.
Yeah. Just right there, a small patch. And it looked like you bush hog a patch or the Holstein's in it or something.
Okay. So that's a performance issue.
Yeah. Okay. So based on what's here, and based on those comments, it is as is. That's all you have to go on. As is this conversation, what is our action?
What I'm hearing, to summarize, is that we would not go with the same contractor as last year due to performance issues. We would not go with the second low bidder because they are out of state. We would go with the third low bidder because it's more local.
And in doing that, is there an expectation? How do you parlay, Mark, or how do y'all parlay the staff that you currently have? Is that, so in other words, when we go to the full board of commissions with this recommendation of the third option, the third seat, there needs to be an amendment to that would add how your staff helps us get closer to the general expectation, right? If you already said that this probably ain't enough money, it probably ain't enough, you know, but again, we're willing to give them a shot, we're still gonna fall short of a public expectation. So will your staff be part of the narrative or the solution that says, okay, and here's how we feel that it to get us to at least 85% of the expectations or 90%? I mean, how do you?
Yeah, certainly what we would do is be able to mobilize to do localized, to address localized areas.
Okay.
But I would want it understood that it isn't a replacement for one of the mowing cycles, for example, because
right.
We already have another 300 miles that we're doing.
Yeah. Right. It's sort of like our resurfacing. Mm-hmm. Stay in our lane. Stay in your lane. Don't go full throttle. I understand. But
yeah, let me just touch on something. You know, we're talking about basically going to the highest bidder. Mm-hmm. Well, we're not talking hundreds of thousands of dollars or $500,000, you know, for a building mm-hmm. project. We're talking about $50,000, $51,000 between high and low. And I think if we get a good project, I'd be more than willing to see the taxpayers' money, you know, $50,000 spent for a quality job. And I think taxpayers would too.
Wait, so there's only, I see what, 306 and 307?
Well, 256 minus 307.
No, stay with me. So there's $1,000. We said, number one is already out because we can't work with that. number two is out of state, so we already have our overall, you know, general rule, no out of state. And so three, I mean, so really you got one, you know, I can get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is $7,624 over budget. So we would have to come up $7,000.
We get there. Commissioner Mulcair. Or y'all just tell them not, like, look, our budget is this. Right? Can you not say, look, this is our budget?
No, because then we would have to go to the others and say the same thing, and they would say, oh, we can underbid that.
We can match it.
I said that we get. Commissioner Mulcair, does it work?
We can find $7,000. Okay.
I just want to, yes. Are you okay with saying that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right, so. Next meeting, not this meeting, but we're going to go forward with the recommendation.
There's some
actually that's on the agenda for tonight. So
we discussed it yesterday, but we didn't have this discussion. So people thought it needed to go before
the essentially, we would fill in the blanks with
that's right. This is the blank, right?
Just fill in the
really
blank.
Close
and
to needing these guys to start too.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Here we are.
So we got
to
go.
The argument is none of the commissioners were satisfied with the lowest bidder, and we don't want to send the project out of state. Number one on principle, and number one on practicality.
Yep.
I'm getting called back. Yeah. And getting things. So
plus, once you nullify the NGL, so the other two, they're within 3% of each other. So you could pick the local company.
Yeah.
Okay. Smart guy.
Yeah.
All right.
So. We can justify that.
Right. I'd like to get a recommendation to make a record. I'd like to get a recommendation on what's the name of this firm?
Yellowstone.
Yellowstone Landscape Southeast LLC.
For that firm to be awarded the contract.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Yes, I'd like to insert my own discussion. With the amendment that you're going to have, there's also part of this that your staff, I still want staff supplement. So we're going to say with the staff supplement. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's already in play. It's already in the budget.
But I want it to be said okay. As part of the recommendation that that's key so that we're not just. We already know that the money is short of what it was last year, so you got to have that staff supplement. So
okay. I'm in my motion.
Okay.
I second that amended motion.
All right. So Yellowstone from Smyrna gets the contract as stated with staff supplement. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Move forward.
Okay.
Go ahead, whatever you got to do to make sure Lisa's ready to send her text. Okay, Miguel, keep going.
Okay, very good. Project updates on the next item, Whitestone Culvert. That is moving along. The design, as I updated the committee at the last meeting,
yep.
Is back with the original designer. They have done some field work and began the redesign. We're having a meeting with them for an update tomorrow.
Yep.
And so that's moving along, and yep. We anticipate that we will have preliminary plans and a budget or a preliminary estimate from them within the next 30 days.
Okay.
All right. And make sure Commissioner Guyer is aware. All right. Correct. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Next item is Stuart Mill and Reynolds intersection improvements. We, you know, you've heard updates over the last several
yep.
meetings, and we do have a proposal from them for $110,000. What I need is a recommendation from the committee to re-engage or to expand the contract with Jacobs for $110,659.87.
This is plus, right?
This would be, this is plus.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
All
right.
There you
go. Oh, really? Are you joking?
No, I'm not joking. That's better yet.
Keep it.
All right.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Okay.
I can put two together.
Now, as we are moving along and getting these projects, the SPLOS projects, underway, We're getting down to, and you heard the update from the SPOST manager at the last meeting, that we're getting close to the next batch of projects. And State Route 92 and Anawaki Road intersection improvements, and that's item five, and Douglas Boulevard intersection improvements, the northbound right turn lane, those are the next two projects that we want to go out and do a request for proposals for design.
Okay.
Now, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to
go ahead.
Okay, as it relates to the Douglas Boulevard intersection improvements, there is a threshold question for the committee, because as much as that seems to be a relatively small, benign project, it is actually more complicated than meets the eye. And one of the things that that I need the committee to consider before making a decision on how to proceed is whether this project is going to be done entirely with local funds, SPOST funds in particular, or whether this is a project that would potentially, we would go after state and federal funds.
How much money?
Frankly, we do not know at this point, because we haven't done any scoping on this project.
All right, so Commissioner Wolk here, this for you. A couple years ago, your predecessor awarded a route for the Board of Commission, which we approved, standby engineering firms. There was a total of 10 different categories, from mechanical to civil to electrical to you name it, environmental. We had every engineer category that you probably would be aware of, at least 10 of them, that we approved these standby guys for moments like this. But questions like what I just asked, like, okay, how much this gonna cost? And it's for them to be able to go, you've already got these contracts in place, to go let them do it, give us a quick, you know, broad estimate. We know it gets refined as we come in and come in and come in. But that's why these guys were on standby, because I don't know how to answer that question. Like, what is the order of magnitude here? You know, you're asking us a question we have no idea.
All right, let me fill in some blanks for you.
Please.
And that's the reason I couch the question the way I did.
Okay.
One of the complexities of this particular project is the site, and that is the location where a gas station exists.
Which end of Douglas are we at, guys?
The east end. The east end.
Douglas?
Fairview Road.
We're Highway 5.
You're talking about Douglas Boulevard.
Okay. That's my bad. I'm sorry.
Across from Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah, I was thinking about the gas station.
That intersection is a monster. Right. You got land, but okay, go ahead.
Okay, so one of the things that when you go for federal funds, that you have to do is you have to do environmental assessment. Environmental assessment gets, you know, the more hits you get, more complicated, you have to do more. Eventually, potentially, you have to do remediation before you can do a lane addition, right? So federal funds get complicated because of that potential.
Mm-hmm.
Utilities is also a consideration, because within the 15 foot or so, there's going to be underground utilities that need to be moved, and they need to be moved out of the way. So the project that perhaps, to give you a sense for order of magnitude the best I can, conceptually, if it was going to be $100,000 to the physical construction, then it may be $400,000-$500,000 in remediation because of the site. Mm-hmm. It might be a couple hundred thousand on utility relocation.
Right.
So now you go from $100,000 to $1 million real quick. So the question is, and this is the threshold question, if you are going to pursue federal funds because you do not know what you're getting into necessarily in terms of order of magnitude, to your point, you have to follow the given federal process from the very beginning, including the right-of-way acquisition. Okay. And there was a question raised yesterday at the agenda session about, has anybody contacted the owner about that particular parcel? And the reason I haven't is because if I do, it would taint the federal process.
You only got to work. Okay, I got it. So, I got it.
So, with that in mind, it could be that everything goes well and we get it designed and get it built for a couple hundred thousand. Or it could get potentially a lot more complicated than that. If we go the federal process, you're adding potentially 2 to 3 years to from beginning to end. If you do it locally, perhaps within 3 years, you might be done with this project, from design to construction.
What's wrong with, to your point, is there anything wrong with, if you didn't have the funding mechanism of the SPLOST, I've had one, probably the other way. But seeing that we have the SPLOST that's in place, did we budget this as part of the SPLOST? Is there a number on here? Mark, do you remember? We're down on Douglas Boulevard in the section of improvements. And we're just talking broadly. We're trying to ask some questions. Was this on the list? And did we have a dollar amount associated, or was it just on the list?
Which,
right, north
so,
right.
There's two projects. Southbound, the double turn lanes, no, is not in the SPLOST. That is a separate project. That's primarily a GDOT project.
It has federal funds.
So, northbound, Highway 5, at Douglas Boulevard, making a right-hand turn.
Yep, correct.
That is a SPLOST project. It is above the line, and it is it's year two project.
This year.
How much money? Remember?
No. There is no money associated with it.
Which is fine.
We didn't have, all we had was concept. We had concepts and we had approximate cost estimates. We don't know. I really don't think it would be that expensive except for utilities. Do you already tell them about the utilities?
I didn't. I knew her around potentially.
Yeah, you stand there and look at the utilities.
Surely they took care of the environmental problems when they mitigated that site, but that doesn't
mean. But we would have to test to make sure.
Yeah.
I talked to Marsha Hampton about that corner right there, city manager. And she said the owners out of sight on the price. She said Dunkin' Donut wanted to move across the street, and the price was just out of sight. It was not workable.
We determined how much width we needed. I know we talked about it a long time ago. We talked more on about here that, or we were going to get Howard ready to do it. I don't remember what route we took, or if we took a route. Was getting some survey data to see how much, you know, based on the elevations, how much width do we need to get the roadbed, shoulder, and slope in there.
Yeah, we're probably looking at somewhere between 15 and 20 feet, depending on the elevations. So it's not a super wide swath, but it's pretty long. Because at that 45 mile an hour speed limit, it's going to run 300 feet plus.
I was just guessing 25 in my head, just based on.
You got to do something with that radius.
A little bit high.
You got to do something with that radius.
If the elevator, if you got to chase the grade, then I can see it going to 25.
So, and what we were hoping when they started developing the shopping center, and I know Commissioner Geyer, things we've been dragging our feet, but what we were hoping was they were going to turn in and sell development plans on that property. Mm-hmm. Discussions with the city indicated that was going to happen. It didn't happen because as part of the development, they would require right-of-way for the property, which would be easy.
So how do we...
So right now, that project is sitting there. The project on the corner.
Northbound.
No, the developer.
Oh, it's the...
Okay. Yep, they dug up the asphalt and grassed it.
Okay, so this is an update. So is there a course of action? Is it just an update, or do we need to move on this? This is your district?
No, it's Ann's, but it's, of course, in the city, and it's state highway.
Is this one of the roads that we took over from the SDS? Was the new Boulevard part of that SDS, those six roads?
No, we went to...
This is Highway 5.
No, that's where we left the room.
Okay.
On Douglas Boulevard, remember that?
Yeah, you did.
So, right. I mean, I think we need to move forward with getting some survey data to
to determine how much right of way we need, and then at least talk to the owner and see where we stand.
Okay, I like you said Howard Ray or whomever. Remind us, now share with Miguel, remember there were 10 firms, engineering firms that your predecessor had, you know, it was McCann, we
on had call, these, yeah.
On demand, on call.
Yeah, I don't remember that was 10 of them. I don't think there was a surveyor in there. There may have been.
I mean, you had everything else. You had mechanical, civil, whatever.
But I think, we need to talk to Moreland. I think Moreland.
But can they do this work in spite of force? But can they do this work in spite of being our program manager? And that's what I was thinking about Howard more than anything. I don't.
That's touchy there, but I don't know whether those standby contracts are still valid because they usually have an expiration.
Yeah. But would you like the concept though? I mean, we've been along with like okay, just to have them, but to answer the question, well, how much is this going to cost before we figure out how much it's going to cost?
So if we don't have standby, and we'll just get a price. We'll get a price from Howard or somebody else.
Right, so do we need to move on this?
I mean, it shouldn't be that big of a cost just to get some data to determine how much right of way.
Right, so no action until you come back with, unless this preliminary estimate. That agreed?
Yeah.
I mean, there's nothing to act on, nothing to recommend to the full board of commissioners until you come back with a little bit more
facts. Right, yeah.
And then depending on what kind of price we get on obtaining this survey data, I mean, we can just go ahead and do it.
Right. Chairman, let me draw this back to item four there.
Yes.
I misspoke every time I see anything on Stuart Mill, but the Stuart, West Stuart Mill in Yancey is a O2 SPLOST project.
Mm-hmm.
This Stuart Mill in Reynolds.
It's 2016.
That's a 2016 SPLOST.
It was a 2002.
It's turned
ran
into
out of money.
Okay.
There's no money left for that intersection. So we bumped it to the very first intersection project for the 2016.
Okay, but I thought there was 2002 SPLOST money for West Stuart Mill and Yancey.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, 2002.
About 2.9 million.
Yeah, 16 years. We burned it up, boy.
So, did we talk about, while I was out, did we talk about Stuart Mill Reynolds?
Yes.
Yep.
So, were we good with the recommendation to go to the commissioners for the 110?
A little less than 110.
No, we just, it was sort of an update. I didn't hear a call to
ask. It's not on tonight's agenda.
No, no. Okay.
But if we can get a recommendation, we can put it on the next agenda.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm gonna lean to the other end.
Yeah, that's my district, and I make a recommendation that we enter into a, would you say, an amended agreement? Or no, it's a new agreement?
We amend the current agreement for a design service.
Okay, with Jacobs Engineering?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes. To then, and let me read you exactly.
In an amount not to exceed 110?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay.
Second. Yeah, this one's been going on way too long. Not our fault. There's been no one for a while.
Okay. So, Commissioner Mulcair made a motion. You second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passed.
So, we'll get that on the next agenda?
Not this one.
Yes.
This next one.
Okay.
All right. And again, we promised to use Chesapeake Committee to keep the projects going for the SPLOS where we'll be when we're asked, but we just need more data. You know, just make sure we have the data. All right. Keep going. Last one. SR 92 in Anawake. You're going to cut a road from Riverside?
Okay, well, that's...
I'm joking.
I did. That's one of the next intersection improvements, and essentially, there is no action at this time other than us going out for design service, supporting an RFQ.
Of course, what is that?
Again, this is so we don't need an engineering preliminary with the standby guys. We just go straight to an RFQ. That our standard?
Mm-hmm.
And this is a SPLOS project?
Yes, sir.
On the list.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
It's on the list.
Yep. It's funded. It's in line.
It's in line accordingly. Okay. Can I get a motion?
I make a motion that we
send out an RFQ for design for State Route 92 and Wakey Road intersection improvements.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. It's called action. Thank you. Is there anything else that needs to come forward this transportation committee?
No, sir.
My county administrator?
I don't think so. Whitestone Culvert project update's the same as the last meeting. Because we were 3 months out on the design of the culvert. So.
Yeah, I gave them a little update on that.
Oh,
they've done some field work and we're going to have a meeting tomorrow to see what the findings are.
Okay.
We're good on that.
Yep, we're good.
All right, Commissioner Wilker, close out. Good. Anything else?
Good.
All right.
Good stuff.
My meeting stands adjourned. Thank you all. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.